Good morning, everyone. We would be doing the next poem in your syllabus, after Wordsworth, that is, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner by S.T. Coleridge. Coleridge and Wordsworth wrote collaboratively in the lyrical ballads, and they have written many poems, but Wordsworth is known for his nature poetry, whereas Coleridge is known for the use of the supernatural element in his poems. The Rime of the Ancient Mariner is a lyrical ballad, that is, it's a poem written in the form and style of a folk ballad, which is usually written by an anonymous person and transmitted orally, usually. The ballad is a narrative song poem, usually relating a single dramatic incident or story in a form suitable for singing or rhythmical chanting. Folk ballads often have sudden dramatic beginnings, are written in the form of a dialogue, usually between the narrator and the listeners as well as between the characters. The language is simple, but there is plenty of repetition and use of archaic, old-fashioned, old English words. There is sudden change of action besides music and rhythm. The poem contains all these characteristics. Hence, it is a ballad. The Rime of the Ancient Mariner is a ballad, although not a folk ballad. We would start with the first part of the poem. The poem is about how the ancient mariner's ship sailed past the equator and was driven by storms to the cold regions towards the South Pole. From thence, the ship sailed back to the tropical latitude of the Pacific Ocean. How the ancient mariner cruelly and inhospitably killed a seabird called Albatross, and how he was followed by many and strange distresses, and also how he could come back to his own country. Let me read the first four lines of the poem. It's an ancient mariner, and he stoppeth one of three. By thy long grey beard and glittering eye, now wherefore stoppest thou me? These are the first four lines of the poem. Here, the poet talks about how he saw three men and he stops them and ask them to listen to the story. The first line of the poem is the poet's comment, who introduces the central character, an old mariner. The poem thus begins abruptly without any introduction, and the main character of the poem, that is the mariner, stops or detains one of the three wedding guests who are going to attend a marriage feast. When we come to the third line of the poem, we are introduced with a wedding guest who is surprised by the strange mariner's audacity to stop him. This wedding guest notices the two striking features of the mariner's appearance, his long grey beard and his eyes shining. The wedding guest is annoyed, irritated with the mariner for stopping him, and asks him, "Why do you stop me, or why have you stopped me?" He says that the doors are wide open to welcome the guests, and I am a close relative of the bridegroom's family, and my presence at the wedding is a must. He says the wedding feast has been laid on the table, and I can hear the happy sounding noise of singing and dancing. The merry din means noise, indicates the marriage festivity. The personal appearance of the mariner is gradually developed, wherein the first stanza, the poet gives us a little detail about mariner's long grey beard and glittering eye. In the third stanza, he talks about his lean and thin hand. In this stanza, the mariner physically stops the wedding guest by catching hold of his hand and starts narrating his story to the wedding guest, such as there was a ship. However, the guest, finding it very unusual and strange, holds off his hand and says, "Let go my hand, you old crazy fellow." The mariner at once lets go the wedding guest's hand because he knows he can hold his attention even otherwise. Let me read the lines. He holds him with his glittering eye. The wedding guest stood still and listens like a 3 years child, and mariner hath his will. The hypnotizing effect of the old mariner. He stops him with a glittering eye and starts narrating his story, and the guest listens like a helpless child to the story. In the fourth stanza of the poem, the mariner casts a hypnotic spell on the wedding guest. That is, instead of holding the guest by his hand, the mariner now holds him with his glittering eye, and the wedding guest, on being hypnotized by the mariner, listens to him obediently and helplessly. The last line of this stanza has two connotations, that is, the mariner succeeded in having his way. He succeeded in doing what he wanted to do, to make the wedding guest listen to his story. The mariner succeeded in getting full control of the wedding guest by making him agree to listen to the story. The wedding guest sat on a stone. He cannot choose but hear, and thus spake on that ancient man, the bright-eyed mariner. In this stanza, the hypnotized wedding guest sits on a stone and is left with no option but to hear the mariner who has hypnotized him with his glittering eyes. Since the wedding guest has been hypnotized by the ancient mariner, he is helpless and cannot exercise his own will, so he is compelled to listen to the bright-eyed mariner's story of sin and suffering. Let me read. The ship was cheered, the harbor cleared, merrily did we drop, below the kirk, below the hill, below the lighthouse top. In this stanza, the mariner begins his story like, our friends and relatives gave a cheerful send off when our ship set sail. The ship crossed the harbor very quickly and entered the main sea waters. The sailors sailed away happily, unaware of the disaster that awaited their ship. They were merrily sailing across the ebb tide. As the ship sailed away from the coast, the church, the hill, and the lighthouse on top of the hill disappeared from the sailor's view. Let me read the next stanza. The sun came up upon the left, out of the sea came he, and he shone bright, and on the right went down into the sea. In this stanza, the mariner says that the sun rises on the left-hand side of the ship. This means that the ship was sailing toward the south. There is a picturesque touch in this line. The sun seemed to rise from and set into the sea. The use he refers to the sun here, which was rising from the sea. The mariner further says that it was shining brightly on the right side of the ship. There is also internal rhyme in the line. The word at the end of the first phrase is rhyming with the end of the second phrase. Let us go on to the next stanza. Higher and higher every day, till over the mast at noon, the wedding guest here beat his breast, for he heard the loud bassoon. In this stanza, the mariner says that the sun seemed to attain greater height with the passage of each day, meaning that the ship was nearing the equator. And when the ship came to the equator, the sun was directly over the mast of the ship. The sun is 90 degrees at noon at the equator. However, the sudden sound of the bassoon diverted the hypnotized wedding guest's attention, and he protested his forceful detention as well as showed his impatience and displeasure. Going on to the next stanza. The bride hath paced into the hall, red as a rose is she, nodding their heads before her goes the merry minstrelsy. In these lines, the wedding guest, on recovering his consciousness, noticed that the wedding ceremony had started. The bride, whose face was as beautiful as a red rose, was being brought into the hall in the accompaniment of singers and musicians who were moving their heads as they were singing and leading the bride to the hall. The use of the word pace is more musical and poetic than walked and entered, as is suggestive of the bride's elegant gait, whereas the red as a rose is she is a simile whereby the poet through the wedding guest says that the bride is as beautiful as a red rose. The meaning of minstrelsy is a body of singers, group of singers and musicians who lead the bride to the hall. Going on to the next stanza, the wedding guest, he beat his breast, yet he cannot choose but hear, and thus spake on that ancient man, the bright-eyed mariner. Through these lines, the poet tells that despite all his protests, the wedding guest is not allowed to go. The ancient mariner continues to narrate his story. This is because the mariner has hypnotized him, and now the guest has no option but to hear the story of bright-eyed mariner, ancient mariner. Going on to the next few lines of the poem. And now the storm blast came, and he was tyrannous and strong. He struck with his overtaking wings and chased us south along. In this stanza, the mariner resumes his narrative by creating thrill and excitement from the very first line of this stanza. The mariner says that a strong sea storm rose. He, in the third line of the stanza, refers to the storm. So, storm has been personified as very violent and fierce. The storm overtook the ship, which was caught in its fury. It is to be noted that the storm has been compared to a huge and swift bird of prey or a winged monster which pounces upon the ship, its prey. The ship was forcibly driven by the storm towards the South Pole. Moving on to the next stanza. With slopping masts and dipping prow, as who pursued with yell and blow, still treads the shadow of his foe, and forward bends his head. The ship drove fast, loud, roared the blast, and southward aye, we fled. In these lines, the mariner says that the ship was bent forward by the force of the wind, going up and down the waves. Its forepart was often submerged into the water. The ship looked like a person on the run, being chased by an enemy who is shouting and pursuing with all this force. Just like a man running fast bends his head forward, the front part of the ship was also bent forward. The mariner further says that the enemy is so close that his shadow is falling on the person being chased. The storm continued to blow, and it quickly carried away the ship towards the South Pole. Moving on to the next stanza. And now there came both mist and snow, and it grew wondrous cold, and ice, mast high, came floating by, as green as emerald. In these lines, the mariner continued to narrate his story to the wedding guest. The mariner says that the ship reached the South Pole full of mist and snow. The cold was really unbearable. Icebergs as high as the mast of the ship were floating here and there in the sea. And the greenish reflection of the sea makes the icebergs look like emerald. Moving on to the next stanza. And through the drifts, the snowy cliffs did send a dismal sheen, nor shapes of men nor beast we ken. The ice was all between. The mariner through these lines says that there were all around the drifts. Drifts means floating ice. And the icebergs, though shining, presented a sad and a gloomy sight. He further says that we could not see any human being or any animal in that cold region, as huge masses of snow blocked the view. The extent and spread of ice all around the ship has been emphasized with the repetition of the words like ice here and there and all around. In all there, there was ice all around. Next stanza. The ice was here, the ice was there, the ice was all around. It cracked and growled and roared and howled like noises in a swamp. The extent and spread of ice all around the ship has been emphasized with repetition of the words like ice here, there and all around. In all, there was ice all around. The words cracked and growled and roared and howled collectively convey their meaning through the sound they produce. The splitting up of huge chunks of ice, their sliding and falling into the sea have been described here with these onomatopoeic words. Besides, there is also a simile in like noises in a swound. This means the noise produced by the splitting icebergs are such as the distant thundering and rumbling heard by a person in a fainting fit. Moving on to the next stanza. At length did cross an albatross. Through the fog it came, as if it had been a Christian's soul. We hailed it in God's name. In this part of the poem, we are introduced with Albatross, who plays a pivotal, central role in the poem. Continuing his narration to the wedding guest, the mariner says that after a considerable time had passed, an albatross came through the fog. The albatross is a very huge, chiefly white oceanic and an ice-winged, stout, fat-bodied bird, which has long, narrow wings and is mainly found in the Pacific and Southern Oceans. The mariner considers and compares the bird with Christian's soul and hails, welcomes it in God's name. It is to be noted that the albatross was the first living being the sailors came across in the region of the mist and snow. Believing that it was just like them, a creature of God, the sailors welcomed it on board their ship. Its arrival lifted their spirits and brought them hope. I ate the food it never had. Moving on to the next stanza. It ate the food it never had eat, and round it flew. The ice did split with a thunder fit. The helmsman steered us through. Talking about albatross, the mariner says that sailors gave it food that they were caring for themselves. The bird had never had such food earlier, and it was hovering the ship because there was food there. The albatross cut the ice or the iceberg and made a way for the ship. Then the ship started moving and the sailor, one who is driving the boat, started steering the ship. The sailor, in fact, skillfully managed to steer the ship through the gap. In the next stanza, a good south wind sprung up behind. The albatross did follow, and every day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow. The mariner further says that now a favorable south wind began to blow from behind. The albatross was still following the ship and would come and sit on the mast or the ropes tying the sails to the mast. Every day it responded to the mariner's call to take food or to play with them and other sailors on the boat. In the next stanza, in mist or cloud, on mast or shroud, It perched for vespers nine, whilst all the night through fog smoke white glimmered the white moonshine. The albatross would come and sit on the mast or on the sails at the time of the evening prayer. During this period, the moon shone dimly through the smoke like white fog. The atmosphere in this stanza is, the sky was overcast with clouds. There was almost mist all around. Even the nights were foggy. Piercing through this fog, the moonbeams could be seen shining dimly. The word Vespers refers to an evening time prayer in the churches. Thus, Vespers 9 can mean a period of 9 days. 9 is a magical number that fascinated Coleridge, whereas the word shroud here stands for the sail of the ship, the cloth, white cloth. Moving on to the next. God save thee, ancient mariner, from the fiends that plague thee thus. Why lookest thou so? With my cross bow I shot the albatross. In this stanza, which is the end of the first part, the ancient mariner looked terrified. The wedding guest wished God to shower mercy on him and protect him from devils. Fiends means devils that tortured him. He asked the mariner why he looked thus. The mariner simply replied, I shot the albatross with my crossbow. The ancient mariner has wantonly killed the innocent albatross who had brought new hope to the sailors and whose arrival coincided with the blowing of the south wind. It was criminal to kill the very creature who had brought a turning point for the better in their lives. Here we end the first part of the poem. We will continue the second part in the next video. Thank you for patiently listening.